Thanks, Indranil and Parameshwaran, for inviting me to give this talk. It'll be a very elementary talk. It's an attempt to quantize various moduli spaces using the Quillen determinant line construction. So I'll give the references later. So the outline of my talk is introduction to geometric quantization. I will give a brief introduction. Then Quillen's determinant line bundle. Then motivating example, geometric quantization of the moduli space of flat connection. Then I'll talk about the vortex moduli space. And then I'll talk about two general theorems, then the Hitchin system and its quantum bundles, and modified Cyberg-Witten in two dimension and its pre-quantum bundles. So geometric quantization, a quick introduction. Moduli space of solutions to various equations arising from physics often carry symplectic structure. Given a symplectic manifold, there are these axioms of quantization. So functions on the moduli space are being assigned to operators which act on a certain Hilbert space, such that f goes to f hat. F is constant means f hat is a multiplication operator, and the Poisson bracket goes to the commutator. That means if f3 is the Poisson bracket of f1, f2 with respect to, the Poisson bracket is with respect to the symplectic form, then the commutator must go to, a commutator of f1, f2, f1 hat, f2 hat is minus ih cross f3 hat. So this is the axiom of quantization we are following, and any way of prescribing it is actually, any way of defining it is actually fine. Geometric quantization is a special one, first developed by Constance Sorio, and Kirillov also is associated with this. So if omega is a symplectic manifold such that the symplectic is integral, then geometric, there is a line bundle L on M omega such that its curvature is proportional to the symplectic form. This can always be done, especially if M is compact, this can always be done. And this is called the pre-quantum line bundle. This line bundle should come with a metric, and the Hilbert space of pre-quantization is the space of square integrable sections of L. And what is the operator f hat? The f hat operator is, if f belongs to C infinity M, then we associate an operator acting on some Hilbert space. We'll see what that is. F hat is minus ih cross xf minus ih cross theta xf plus f. What is xf? Xf is the Hamiltonian vector field corresponding to f. Theta is the symplectic form, a symplectic potential, that is omega is d theta. Well, roughly omega is the curvature, so theta acts as a connection, and you can take the covariant derivative with respect to that along the xf direction plus f. So this is a multiplication operator and this is a derivative operator. And the nice thing about it is it satisfies all the axioms of quantization we had. And the f1 hat, f2 hat commutator is equal to minus ih cross f3 hat. This also follows. And what does this f hat act on? Well, square integrable sections of line, it acts on square integrable sections of this line, pre-quantum line bundle. But this is actually a too big a Hilbert space. So geometric quantization involves searching for a polarization and take polarized sections as the Hilbert space. So what is holomorphic quantization? If the pre-quantum bundle is holomorphic, one could take holomorphic sections as polarized sections. But for a general F, F hat does not take polarized sections to polarized sections. So only some functions can quantize this way. I'll take a very basic example, say R2 with PQ coordinates. Then you know that omega is dp with dq, and the symplectic potential is pdq. And if you do the geometric calculation, then p hat is minus ih cross del del q, and q hat is ih cross del del p plus q. But the usual canonical quantization says p hat is this, but q hat is just q. There is no operator like this in the usual canonical quantization. So to get back the canonical quantization, we need to take polarized sections, functions which depend on Q alone. Then it goes back to the, it matches with the canonical quantization. Another example which comes up in quantization of spin, the holomorphic quantization of S2. So S2 is identified with CP1 as a Kaehler manifold. Now you take Z as coordinates on S2, the Kaehler form is given by this. And you take the symplectic form to be N times the Kaehler form, where N is an integer. And it's an integral Kaehler form. Now you take the connection to be I n by 2, Z dz bar, Z bar dz divided by 1 plus ZZ bar. This is the connection. And covariant derivative acting on sections on the pre-quantum line bundle are given by del minus IA. So if you write out the equation of holomorphicity, then you get psi to be this, exponential minus n by 2 log 1 plus ZZ bar FZ. FZ is a holomorphic function of Z. And this quantity is nothing but the Kaehler potential for omega. And the inner product is, the inner product defining the Hilbert space is minus I alpha. Alpha is a physical parameter. Dz, dz bar, 2 pi, 1 plus ZZ bar to the power n by n plus 2, F1 star, F2. Since Fz is holomorphic, this can be finite only when Fz, then the basis of non-singular wave functions is given by when Fz is 1, z, z squared, z to the power n, and because our higher powers won't give finite norm. And the dimension of this Hilbert space is therefore n plus 1. This is relevant to physics. A particle of spin n by 2 has a phase space, the quadrant orbit of SU2, which corresponds to a sphere, and the Hilbert space of quantization is the one as above. I didn't give you the full story. These are also known as coherent states, and there is very beautiful physics related to this. The coherent states actually behave very much like classical states, the equation, and this operator, the flow is actually determined by this operator. So d psi dt is f hat psi. So that is the connection between the coherent states and the. So anyway, I didn't tell you that part. Now Quillen's determinant in bundle. So now A is the space of unitary connections on a vector bundle E associated to a principal G bundle on a Riemann surface sigma. We can identify A with A01 because A10 star is minus A01. On this infinite dimensional vector space, we can define the determinant line bundle of Quillen. This is Quillen's very famous work on, I'll give the references later. One defines the Cauchy-Riemann operator on sigma locally written as this. We'll denote it by del bar A, and construct the line bundle as top wedge curve del bar A star tensor with top wedge, wedge top kernel del bar A star tensor with wedge top co-kernel del bar A. Well, there is an algebraic geometric way of defining all this, but this is also an equivalent. And the problem is the kernel of del bar A jumps even locally, but the whole object makes sense after certain identification, which is there in Quillen's ingenious paper. Quillen further showed that L carries a metric and a connection, and the color potential is the, there is a, you can construct a Laplacian with respect to that del bar operator, and the zeta function of that, zeta prime zero, is the Kaehler potential, and the curvature turns out to be proportional to this form, minus half integral sigma trace of alpha wedge beta. Alpha and beta are infinitesimal deformations of A01. So we will use this construction for our, and the motivating example was the moduli space of flat connection. Geometric quantization of the moduli space of flat connections on principal G bundles on a compact Riemann surface. So the names associated to this are Witten, Axelrod, Della Pietra, Narasimhan, Boville, Dreze, Anderson, and many others. If A is the space of connection on a principal G principal bundle G, or on any associated line principal on an associated vector bundle E, if N is the moduli space of flat connection, then N is flat connection. So N is FA equals to 0 mod out by G. These are all unitary connections. And there's a gauge group acting. The gauge group, one has to mod out by the gauge group. But this is still not a manifold. It's only an algebraic variety. But one can still talk about a symplectic structure. And Marsden-Weinstein's quotient construction goes through. And omega alpha beta is this. This is the one with descent. This is the one which descends. And so therefore, one can construct the Quillen bundle on this. And it also descends to the moduli space. And its curvature is proportional to the descent of this. And one can take holomorphic, it's a holomorphic bundle. And one can take holomorphic sections. And it's the Hilbert space of quantization. When you have holomorphic sections, one can even find out its dimension, and Witten showed that the Hilbert space can be identified with the space of conformal blocks in a certain conformal field theory, the West-Zumino-Witten model. And its dimension is given by the Verlinde formula, and it was rigorously proved by Narasimhan, Dreze, Bovill, Anderson, and many others. So my work is trying to extend this, at least in principle, to certain other situations, like the vortex moduli space for compact Riemann surface, Hitching system for a compact Riemann surface of genus G greater than or equal to 2, modified dimensionally reduced Seiberg-Witten equations on a Riemann surface. And then we derived a general theorem that a suitable tetrapod, if you are given any Kähler manifold or any symplectic manifold such that the form is integral, and they are of course compact, then a suitable tensor prod power of the pre-quantum line bundle of geometric quantization can always be realized as a Quillen bundle. Holomorphic Quillen determinant bundle on integral compact symplectic and Kähler manifolds. So first let's start with the vortex moduli space. This will be very important in our study, so I study it first. The vortex moduli equations are as follows. Sigma is a Riemann, compact Riemann surface, and omega is half h squared dz with dz bar, the volume form on it. A is a unitary connection on a U1 principal bundle P. L be a complex line bundle associated to P. Psi is a section of L. There is a Hermitian metric H on L. Then A psi will be said to satisfy the vortex equations if F is half 1 minus mod psi A squared h omega and del bar a psi equals to 0. Fa is the curvature of the connection and this is the covariant derivative operator. And S is the space of solutions to 1 and 2. There's a gauge group acting and one can take quotient by gauge group and call it the moduli space M. And this integral sigma f of a, if you integrate it, you get a number. If a number comes, and that is called the vortex number. By theorems of Taubes, Bradlow, Garcia Prada, one has the moduli space of vortices is parameterized by the zeros of psi. Thus, the moduli space is a symmetric product. In, to the power n, the vortex number of sigma. Then the Riemann surface is CP1. This is the case will be important for us. Then the Riemann surface is S2. Then the moduli space is complex projective space CPN. One can define a metric like this. This is the connection part and this is the psi part. Star alpha 1 wedge alpha 2 I real part of beta 1 wedge beta 2, all these integrated over sigma. And the complex structure is defined by the Hod star and I. The odd star is the one which on alpha 1, 0 form, it's minus I, and on alpha 0, 1, it's I. So, and one can show that the, if you, on the configuration space, this is so gi xy equals to 2 omega xy. This is a Kaehler form on the configuration space, and one can in fact show that it actually descends to the moduli space. This is a very usual kind of situation. This form keeps appearing again and again, and there's a moment map construction by which one can show actually this descends. So now, this is a trick which a lot of people use. In particular, Biswas and Raghavendra use this method, which I'm going to describe, for constructing the determinant line bundle on moduli space of spectral triples on a curve. So supposing you have, you define the determinant of del bar A on the configuration space, and this is the Quillen metric, e to the power minus zeta prime A0, the zeta function part, and then you multiply it by a factor, e to the power minus I by 4 pi integral M mod psi A square H. So it's the same determinant bundle, but the metric is modified by this spinner part. So, and the first part contributes to this, and the second part contributes to this. And so, and one can show that this actually descends to the moduli space. So this modified Quillen determinant bundle descends to the moduli space if omega is integral, and indeed its curvature is I by omega 2 pi, where omega is the descendant of the symplectic form of the on the affine space to the moduli space. The integrality condition holds if the Riemann surface is of integral area. So integrality condition doesn't always hold. It is true only if the underlying Riemann surface is of integral area. So, so we are in the situation geometric quantization because we have constructed a line bundle whose curvature is proportional. The proportionality is 2 pi I. I by 2 pi, sorry, I by 2 pi of omega, and so we are in the situation for geometric quantization. Well, there is more explicit way of writing the vortex moduli space, symmetric product of Riemann surface, and there is a Samuels, Manton, and Nasir Kaehler form on it, which is on, when the Riemann surface is S2 of radius R, then the form looks like this. 4 R squared delta R S divided by this factor 2. This BS is a little bit mysterious, but there is, this won't really matter so much for our construction. So if this is integral, then the homology class of omega is L times the homology class of the Fubini's 2D metric. This can be shown. And Romau showed that if we can fine-tune the volume of the sphere such that L is equal to 1, we can fine-tune the volume of the sphere such that L becomes 1, and the homology class of omega is exactly the Fubini's 2D metric on CPM. Now we are ready for the more general theorem. Holomorphic determinant bundle on integral compact Kaehler form, Kaehler and symplectic manifolds. Given an integral Kaehler form omega on a compact Kaehler manifold, there is a holomorphic line bundle L on the manifold with a connection and a curvature proportional to omega. So this is in the setting of geometric quantization. We show that the following, in the following theorem, that a high enough tensor product of L is indeed a Quillen determinant bundle. So this is a theorem with Mathai Varghese. Any compact Kaehler manifold M with integral Kaehler form omega parameterizes a natural holomorphic family of Cauchy-Riemann operators, del bar A with A belongs to M. On CP1, the complex structure is on CP1, such that the Quillen determinant line bundle, determinant of del bar, is isomorphic to L tensor K as holomorphic line bundles, where L is the holomorphic line bundle determined omega for sufficiently large K. And the proof is really simple. First, we show the above theorem for CPN. First, we establish the theorem for complex projective space CPN for all integers n and for k equals to 1. This is achieved by viewing CPN as a moduli space of n vortices on CP1. We just showed that moduli space of vortices actually carry a Cauchy-Riemann operator. And we just showed that 1 over 2 pi omega is omega fs, Kubin is to be, the cohomology class of 1 over 2 pi omega is omega fs. So we have this Quillen bundle already on CPN. And one can show that this bundle is actually isomorphic as a holomorphic line bundle to the hyperplane bundle, which is the dual of the tautological bundle on CPN. And its curvature is proportional to omega fs. So our next step is just to apply the Kodaira embedding theorem to a certain projective space to establish the theorem in general. So you have a compact Kaehler matrix with integral Kaehler form. So with Kodaira embedding theorem, you can embed it in a large enough CPN. Actually, you use the geometric, the line bundle from geometric quantization to do this. Pi k of m is embedded into projectivized H0 m theta tensor LK star, dual of that. And this is CPN for a large enough m. And what one can show by Kodaira embedding, that phi k star omega fs is actually k times omega, where omega fs is the Fubini's 2D form on CPN. And in phi k star h, the hyperplane, therefore, hyperplane bundle is isomorphic as a holomorphic line bundle to L tensor k. But then the hyperplane bundle was a determinant line bundle, and hence we have our theorem. A little bit proof is needed, but this is generally the idea. And the symplectic analog, so this one was actually geometric quantization because we had holomorphic sections and so on. But for general symplectic integral compact manifold, we don't have holomorphicity. The L is we only have pre-quantization there, and we use Gromov's embedding theorem. So any compact symplectic manifold M with integral symplectic form omega parameterizes a natural smooth family of Cauchy-Riemann operators, L bar A on CP1, such that the determinant line bundle is actually L. There is no tensor, there's no power K here, because this is the nature of the Gromov embedding. As complex line bundles where L is the pre-quantum line level determinant. So here we establish this using Gromov embedding, and we don't need this tensor power K in this case. So it exactly is a pre-quantum line bundle. The pre-quantum line bundle is exactly a Quillen bundle. So I am actually looking for applications for this. Especially related to coherent states I'll come to that maybe in the end. And now the Hitchin system, we are in a Higgs bundle conference. So P is a principal SUN bundle on a Riemann surface, compact genus G greater than or equal to 2. A, B are unitary connection on P, and phi is omega 1, 0, sigma at P tensor C. Then the self-dual Young-Mills equation on R4 when reduced to a Riemann surface R, this is all in the paper, self-duality equations on a Riemann surface. Fa is equal to minus phi star, del bar A phi equals to 0. And there's a gauge group action which keeps the equations invariant. So one can talk about the Hitchin moduli space. And we saw a lot about this in this conference. The Hitchin moduli space turns out to have a rich structure. In particular, it has a hyper-Kaehler structure, three symplectic forms, omega, q1, and q2, derived from a hyper-Kaehler metric and three complex structures. We show that there are three pre-quantum line bundles corresponding to these symplectic forms, whose curvature are proportional to this symplectic forms. Moreover, these are holomorphic respect to their complex structures. The very first, for example, the very first one can be written as minus half integral m trace of alpha wedge beta plus half integral m trace of gamma wedge delta. This is the infinitesimal deformation of the alpha and beta are for the connection, and these are for the Higgs part. And the first, again, if we consider the determinant del bar, sorry, I forgot to put a bar on this, and that gives you the, and the Quillen metric is modified. Exponential minus zeta prime day zero, that gives you this part. And the other one, it has got a little cut, but it was exponential I by 4 pi this quantity, which if you take the curvature, if you just calculate the curvature, it's I by 4 pi trace of gamma wedge delta. So it's exactly what one would do naturally. And the curvature of P is precisely I by 2 pi omega. It can be shown that the first symplectic form is integral. This actually I discussed with Indranil, and he told me how to prove this. And P descends to the moduli space of the Hitchin system, and its curvature is proportional to the first symplectic form, and the constant of proportionality being I by 2 pi. Thus, it's a pre-quantum bundle corresponding to the first symplectic form. And thus, once again, we are in the setting for geometric pre-quantization. And we take square integrable sections of these bundles as a, and the other two, the point is the other two symplectic forms can also be quantized using Quillen bundle construction. And all these are holomorphic with respect to their respective complex structures. And therefore, one can take holomorphic sections of these line bundles to be the appropriate Hilbert spaces. I haven't been able to calculate the dimensions, but it's possible, I think. So if we start now, how is it all written, related to Chern-Simons gauge theory? If we start with an SU2 gauge group, then in fact, using the flatness of the SL2C connection, A plus phi star is equivalent to the Hitchin equation. One can use Chern-Simons SL2C gauge theory to get quantization of the Hitchin system. This is using co-cycle line bundles. So we could show that our pre-quantum line bundles are very much related to this co-cycle line bundle. And I'm hoping that using this, one can calculate the dimension of the Hilbert spaces. Then there is another construction. Then there is another modified Seiberg-Witten moduli space on a Riemann surface. We consider these equations. A is L is a principal U1 bundle, line bundle P on a compact Riemann surface. A is a unitary connection on L. Phi is omega 1 sigma IR, the Higgs field. And psi 1, psi 2 bar are both sections of L. Then we write this kind of equation. FA is related like this to psi 1 and psi 2. And del bar A phi 0 1 is 0. And this part, psi 1, psi 2 bar equals to 0. The A connection part and the Higgs part. So there are now three things. There is a connection component. There is a Higgs component as well as a spinner component. So the gauge group acts like this, as usual, and leaves the equations invariant. And the moduli space is a finite dimensional moduli space. And we could show that at least for certain choices of the line bundle L, N is non-empty. And interestingly, the solutions involved solving a problem of prescribing Gaussian curvature on a Riemann surface in a given conformal class of metrics. So, but I'm still trying to find out general solutions. Maybe there'll be obstruction. And let's see. So, once again, this has a symplectic form which looks very much like the, and there is a moment map construction which N has a symplectic form which is the descendant of this, alpha 1 wedge alpha 2, and then beta 1, eta 1 bar, beta 1 bar, eta 1, and so on. And again, there is a pre-quantum line bundle which gives you this. So now the question is there an algebraic geometric description of this moduli space? In the sense of some stability of certain bundles or something, I don't know exactly. And so I'm trying to see, understand this moduli space better and find the dimension of the Hilbert space, because there's again a complex structure which descends. And moduli space is most probably a Kaehler moduli space. Integrality condition is still a question. And but the pre-quantum line bundle most probably descends. Maybe that will be a proof of the integrality condition. So this is, and then there is another moduli space, dimensional reduction of generalized Seibach-Witten, where the spinners take values in a hyper-Kaehler manifold, and we are also studying its geometric quantization. And this method, we are also looking into finding invariance of hyper-Kaehler manifolds using constructions on this moduli space. So that is another thing in progress. And then there is geometric quantization of the finite TODA system. This may seem a little strange, but the finite TODA system actually has all reasons to be have a geometric quantization, has a geometric quantization, because finite TODA system is related to the Hitchin moduli space. And also, it has a coadjoint orbit description, where the Lie group is upper triangular matrices, and Lie algebra is upper triangular matrices, and there's a coadjoint orbit description proved by Adler and others. And coadjoint orbits have very nice constructions of quantum bundle given by Constant Soriot and others. So geometric quantization of finite TODA system seems very possible. And I'm trying to relate it to the usual quantum finite TODA system. This is, by the way, joint work with Dilip Jatkar. And this is joint work with Varun Thakre. And then finally, the question of studying the role of coherent states in geometric quantization of various moduli spaces. Coherent states are the natural states which appear from geometric quantization, in the sense that, it depends on how one defines coherent states, but let me just say that they are very they naturally emerge from geometric quantization, and they are closest to the classical states. So, in a sense, their evolution is what I'm concerned about, and how they relate to the fact that they come as sections of a Quillen bundle, whether that will play an important role. So that is what I'm studying. And finally, I would like to thank Professor Leon Taktojan for introducing me to Quillen bundles in the first place. Thank you. Oh, finite TODA system, I get it from coadjoint orbits. So you write it as a lax pair, And there are these lax pair has certain off diagonal and little of some off diagonal terms. What they do is they Adler's paper they forget the lower diagonal part, and it's an upper triangular matrix. So this TODA system can be therefore described very nicely by a quadrant action on this upper triangle. It is exactly contained in a quadrant orbit. In fact, it can be described by a quadrant orbit. It's a full quadrant orbit. And they are very nice, So, and the symplectic form can also be written very nicely. It's not exactly the standard symplectic form. Yeah, it is the symplectic form on the quadrant orbit, but in terms of, when you write it in terms of the parameters in the lax operator, it's not exactly usual. And so the Hamiltonians of the system, the integrals of motion, they can be quantized using geometric quantization methods. And the coherence states I'm now trying to compute, and their flow. So actually, there are many ways for quadrant orbits. Yeah, so here it is that. But for quadrant orbits, it's very nice in the sense that this the quantum bundle, it also, the Hilbert space also acts as a representation of the group itself. So you can take a state and move it around. G acting on a zero state, the vacuum state, you can just move it around and get the quadrant orbit. So that is very nice for a quadrant orbit. What I mean is, if you move it around, you get the coherent states. And that is very nice property of quadrant orbits, which is not true in general. But then there are very nice theorems. I don't know the proof of these, that any classical mechanical system which has a Hamiltonian action and a moment map and all that into G star, the dual of the Lie algebra, it is actually a finite cover of a quadrant orbit. So quadrant orbits are very important, and geometric quantization of those can possibly give you different ways of quantizing the classical system. So I'm just studying this, but the finite TODA system also appears in some limits of the Higgs bundle, so it will also have a Quillen bundle description. So I would also like to relate the two, and let's see. Quillen metric, yeah.